Hello everyone and welcome back to the channel. Thanks for checking it out if you're new. If you're not familiar with the series, this is what I watch, read, and played. This is where I share what I watch, read, and played during the current month and share some recommendations or maybe some things you shouldn't check out. So let's look at March 2024. So starting off with the movies I watched in March, we have Dune Part 2. This is the sequel to the 2021 remake of Denis Villeneuve's Dune, you know, Frank Herbert's original novel. What is there to say about these two Dune films except...
Yeah, I'm thinking...
I love these new Dune films. There's so much craft and love behind them. The acting is crazy. The directing is good. The cinematography. Everything about this film looks amazing. And the fact that it has like half the budget of most big blockbusters and looks this amazing really shows to the craft behind it. Then, kind of in the opposite direction, for a friend of the channel, PhilWith1L, to celebrate St. Patrick's Day, we watched Leprechaun 2 through 4. And, oh my, did these movies... We watched Leprechaun 1 last year, and they don't get much better than that. They definitely go, like, the Chucky route of they get sillier and sillier each one, except for where Chucky got better as it got sillier, these get worse. So, Leprechaun 2, the leprechaun is trying to steal this woman to marry her. It's very silly, very goofy, a bit problematic. All of them are a bit problematic at times. But we had some laughs with that. 3 is where the leprechaun is in Vegas, and that one is maybe the funniest one. You know, he bites someone and transfers his, like, leprechaun werewolf curse to that guy, and now he is slowly turning into a leprechaun himself. That one is maybe the funniest, has a lot of the hijinks, maybe some of the best kills. These films are also very gory, like, they kind of pride themselves on that. And then finally we watched Leprechaun 4, Leprechaun in Space, and this was definitely the worst one. Like, this one feels super cheap compared to the other two. And I think it actually, if I remember correctly, had the biggest budget. I'm not sure, I don't remember, but yeah, those certainly did... suck. Not gonna lie. I'm sure there are people who enjoy them, but they were definitely not for me. Then, to make up for that, we watched Sinbad with my friend Natalie. This is one of her favorite movies from her childhood, and I had never seen it. So her and I sat down with some of our other friends and we watched it. It's a fun pirate adventure, you know. Sinbad has to go get the Book of Hope. I think it's the Book of Hope. Sorry, Natalie, if I got that wrong. So he has to go get this book from the goddess of mischief and chaos. And so he's off on this adventure, and it's a fun time. Early DreamWorks, when DreamWorks was still doing 2D animation, you know, now everything is 3D. And I kind of wish we still had those. Then, continuing February on this channel, where my friends Morgan, Phil, Sienna, and I... tried to watch all of the Scooby-Doo DC crossovers in February. Yeah, we didn't really make it in February. So continuing it into March, we watched Scooby-Doo and Batman the Brave and the Bold. And I loved this movie. This movie was what I thought all the other crossovers would be, where, like, this one felt like it was more, you know, the other movies or crossovers were maybe the, you know, the DC heroes coming into the Scooby-Doo world. This movie felt like the Scooby gang got transported into the Batman world, and it fits right in with the show Batman the Brave and the Bold. I really like it. I think it's a fun time, and so go check that one out if you're at all curious, and then watch our reaction to it on this channel. Then we watched Scooby-Doo and Crypto 2, which that movie was actually what inspired the whole February, was because I was curious about that movie because of all the, like, canceled, not canceled shenanigans that happened with it last year. So we finally got to it to end off February for now. I know there is one more movie we haven't watched, but maybe we'll do that in October. But yeah, Scooby-Doo and Crypto 2, this is where the gang teams up with Crypto after the Justice League has disappeared to solve the mystery of where the Justice League went. And this one's okay. I did not like it as much as Brave and the Bold. I think it takes a bit long. It also is almost like a bottle episode, which is kind of weird for an animated project, in that, like, the entire thing takes place in the Hall of Justice, and it just gets a little stale. You know, they can only walk down so many hallways, versus Scooby-Doo usually has the crazy environments that they run through and chase. All right, then, because March also seemed to be the month of sequels, I watched Kung Fu Panda, all four of them. I rewatched Kung Fu Panda 1. This is where Po has to learn to become the Dragon Warrior, played by Jack Black. Very funny movie, funnier than I remember it being. It's got its charm. These also are quick, like 90 minutes, so they're really quick watches. I like this first one a lot. You know, it's got a good action set piece too, with the fight with Tai Lung on the bridge. If you haven't seen these, obviously go watch them. You know, these are old movies at this point. Then you got Kung Fu Panda 2, where Po has to go take down Lord Shen, who's threatening to take over China, and he has to learn about inner peace and all that. This is the best one. Everybody knows that. You know, great action set pieces, a really good climax, a really good finale to this movie. And then I watched Kung Fu Panda 3, and this one's okay. It's not as good as the first two. This one follows Po as he takes on General Kai, who's going around collecting the chi of all the Kung Fu masters to become the best and to end Kung Fu. Po then finds the secret village of pandas, and he has to train all of them to, you know, come together. And it's okay. It's not as funny as the other ones, and I think the pacing is a bit slow. I think it works really well, though, as a conclusion to the Kung Fu Panda trilogy. And then we had to go make a fourth one. And Kung Fu Panda 4 is, what if we did 3 again, but worse and cheaper? Yeah, Kung Fu Panda 4 is, Po must once again, you know, take up that leadership position and learn how to become spiritual master of the valley while also taking on the chameleon. And it is pretty boring. Or not boring, but it's pretty short. This is the shortest one. It's like 80 minutes, you know, like 10, 20 minutes shorter than the other ones. And you feel how fast and how little time they have. And apparently this one had a bunch of studio meddling, and you can see that in the final picture. So, Kung Fu Panda is okay. Like, honestly, I hate the idea of streaming movies. You know, I think every movie deserves a shot on the big screen. But you could wait till streaming for Kung Fu Panda 4. And because I had some friends who were interested, I watched Dune Part 1, you know, Dune 2021, again, with some friends who had never seen it before, and we recorded our reaction to it. That'll be coming soon. Like I said before, perfect movies, amazing craft on display. And as you'll see later in this video, I don't know how Denise managed to adapt these movies. Then I've got a mystery movie I'm gonna tag on to April, because even though we watched it in March, I don't want to spoil that video. So that will be in April's What I Watched, Read, and Played. So then, speaking of sequels, we had a new Ghostbusters. So I rewatched all the Ghostbusters. Ghostbusters 1 is a fun, charming movie. You know, the main gimmick of it is, look, it's the SNL guys hunting ghosts. And it's super fun. And it's got humor, both for children and adults. Like, I would think kids would maybe get bored with it, but I see kids as Ghostbusters all the time at Halloween. Then Ghostbusters 2 is less interesting, but I don't know why we all hate it so much. Like, I guess it is almost the first movie again, where the gang has to come all back together again because they've broken up, because the government disbanded them and all that. But I think it's okay. And then there's Ghostbusters Answer the Call, aka Ghostbusters 2016. This is kind of like how the original one was, what if we take all the SNL guys and make them hunt ghosts. This one's, what if we take all the SNL girls and make them go hunt ghosts. And I think this movie's fine. I think this movie got a lot of flack for no reason. You know, a lot of hate for no reason at all. I think the big thing with this is it's a different kind of humor. You know, the first movie is a lot of, like, the Bill Murray kind of stilted adult humor that, you know, you only get if you're really paying attention and you get the joke and it's funny. Not to say it's, like, high-level humor or anything. But then The 2016 film is more of the modern, more, you know, bombastic humor. You've got sexual jokes, fart jokes, body slash slapstick humor, you know, things like that, that are more common in modern day movies, especially from Paul Feig movies. And so I think it actually works well. It's just for maybe a different audience. And not every movie has to be for all audiences. Then I rewatched Ghostbusters Afterlife, which this is the reboot, you know, picking up after 2, you know, ignoring the girls Ghostbusters 1, because that was a hard reboot, which was also a problem with that movie. If it had just been, this is another team of Ghostbusters, I don't think people would have been as mad about it. But Ghostbusters Afterlife is a sequel to Ghostbusters 2, where we see, you know, some odd years later, you now have Egon Spengler's family, his descendants, picking up the title of Ghostbusters and uncovering the mystery of what happened with him and the other Ghostbusters, why they're not still ghostbusting to this day. And I think that movie's a really good requel, you know, a reboot sequel. So I did a whole tier list of those, you know, over on the channel. But I think it does a good job of reinvigorating the Ghostbusters, introducing new audiences to the Ghostbusters, but it's also, it doesn't feel like a studio-mandated film. It feels like this is, if we're going to make a Ghostbusters, we have to pay tribute because Harold Ramis, the actor who played Egon, has passed. And this really does feel like a love letter to Harold Ramis and a really nice tribute. I did not enjoy Frozen Empire. I think most of my frustration with this movie comes from you can see the bones. So this is a sequel to Afterlife where we're following the teenage and the old Ghostbusters as they all work together to solve this mystery of this new entity that is haunting New York. And I think this movie suffers from, as most people have said, there's just way too many characters in this movie. Because now you have all of the Ghostbusters Afterlife characters, plus all of the original characters, and then cameos and things like that, that there just becomes too much going on in this movie. I think this movie needed to be, you know, narrowed down and focused to focus on, like, the team of Phoebe's characters. I won't spoil who works with who in this movie, but Phoebe, the granddaughter of Spengler, she has a good storyline that I like. And I think hers is maybe the more interesting of all the different, and it feels like the main storyline. But instead we have to go, you know, we have to bring back Lucky from Afterlife. We have to bring back Podcast from Afterlife. We have to bring back the mayor from the first movie. Like, you start to pull away from the storyline and it goes too many directions. So I think if you had just stuck with the one storyline, and the OG Ghostbusters can still be here, you can just say that, yeah, they are helping because this is a big cataclysmic event. I just felt like Ghostbusters Frozen Empire, how I just said Afterlife, felt like this nice tribute to Harold Ramis. I felt like Frozen Empire felt like the studio mandated, you know, we gotta make a Ghostbusters, like, every few years mandated title. So, I didn't love it. It's not the worst movie ever. Give it a watch if you're curious when it comes to streaming. Or maybe catch it at a matinee. Then finally I watched Late Night with the Devil. This is an independent horror film distributed by Shudder. And this is following a talk show host that after declining ratings, you know, tries to basically go viral, get the clicks by summoning the devil on his show. And it's a horror comedy. It is funny and also unnerving. You know, it's not like jump scare, ah, get ya. But it makes you uncomfortable, and it's a really good movie at that. I do have to address the AI in the room, that this movie does, unfortunately, use AI images for, like, because it's meant to be, like, a talk show. So they have, like, the cut to commercial. And the cut to commercial images are AI generated. And really, I'm not sure why, because they're nothing crazy that you couldn't have easily hired an artist to do. And while that does suck, it would be a shame to boycott or ignore this film, you know, all the other members of the crew and cast, all their hard work, because of a few couple seconds of AI. Is it terrible? Yes. Don't ever do it again, whoever's choice that was. But the movie is a really good time, and you should definitely go check it out if it's still playing near you. It will obviously be coming to Shudder soon. Then this last one, this isn't a movie, but I wanted to throw it in here. I watched a slime tutorial of the Percy Jackson musical. I've seen this musical a handful of times now. I did this because I did a video on it, because after watching the TV show, I was feeling a little bummed out. Like, I didn't think the TV show was as perfect of an adaptation as I thought it was. So I went and rewatched that musical. And it's such a good adaptation of Percy Jackson. I did a whole video on it. Go watch that video to really hear my thoughts on it. Like I said, if you can find a local production of it, because it's not on Broadway and it's not touring anymore, so that's why I watched the slime tutorial. But if you can find it locally, because like high schools and independent productions can now put it on, definitely go see it that way first. Moving on to TV shows I watch. I didn't make a lot of progress in TV this month. Like, starting off, I'm caught up now with The Bad Batch after watching season 2 last month. So now I've been watching through season 3 as it airs. And I think I like season 3 a lot more than season 2. I feel like The Bad Batch is almost that awkward trilogy, you know. 3 seasons, this season being the last one, and you know, season 2 for me is that awkward middle chapter that kind of meanders because we can't quite get to the climax yet. And so that's where I think I like season 3, is I feel like season 3 is ramping up. I've seen some people online complaining about filler episodes. I don't feel like there have been any filler episodes in season 3. I feel like it's all been very focused, you know. We have the Empire hunting Omega and trying to figure out why they want Omega. And I guess for some people it could be hard because, honestly, it's almost a mystery to the characters more than us. You know, we, the audience, can kind of figure out why the Empire wants Omega. I won't spoil that here. But the characters don't know, and so it's fun watching them learn and grow with that mystery. Then, because X-Men 97 came out this month, and I really want to watch it, but I am one of those like completionist people who needs all the context, even though everybody said it doesn't matter, I am watching through the original X-Men the Animated Series. And so I have watched the first 2 seasons of it so far. And man, oh man, did I forget that Marvel was broke back in the 90s. You know, we look at the MCU now and it's the biggest film franchise ever and the highest grossing. But that wasn't the case. You know, back in the 90s, Marvel was almost bankrupt. That's why we ended up having things like Fox owning the X-Men and the Fantastic Four and Universal owning the Hulk and Sony owning Spider-Man, because they just sold the stuff off to make money. And so I do think this series, you know, animation-wise is definitely limited, but still cool. Like, you can see the bones where it's cheap, and you're like, wow, this came out after Batman the Animated Series. But at the same time, it's very comics accurate. You know, almost to a point where, like, after watching this, I don't know if I really like Wolverine. You know, Wolverine's the main character of the live-action movies, but he's just kind of a grumpy, mean old man in the show. And I'm sure he'll grow on me with time, but I just found that interesting to see kind of how different the X-Men are traditionally. I also think the show is a bit of a hard binge. It is almost one big story, but also episodic. Like, there usually are overarching narratives throughout the season, but then you have an episode where it is just, oh, Jubilee has to go visit her family. And you're like, really? You guys are being, like, hunted by Sentinels right now. And things like that. Or, you know, Gambit has to go visit his family. And it's like, really? Professor X is missing right now. And so, I think it's a mixed bag of a show right now. I am no X-Men expert, but I enjoy it. And I really want to see 97 from the clips I've seen. So, again, I'm watching this for the context. Then Invincible came back with the second half of season 2. And that's been great. You know, the finale is next week. We've seen 3 out of 4 episodes. So far, great action. I love the bit where they point out that animation takes a long time and some of the limitations, you know. Because we all know that Invincible is cheap. You know, it's made cheaply and somewhat limited. They've gotten a bigger budget. You know, season one was kind of a test, and so Amazon didn't give them a ton of money. So the budget got bigger, and I assume it's going to keep getting bigger because people are watching the show. But let's hope season three we get all at once. Not all at once, but at least, you know, no huge mid-season break. Then moving on to things that I read in March. I only read one thing in March, and that's because it's Dune. You know, after seeing the movies, I want to read the books, especially because people said that Villeneuve's isn't necessarily the most accurate. And I can see that here, in that, honestly, I have to give Denis Villeneuve credit, because this book is, I can see where people thought Dune would be unadaptable. You know, things that are mysteries in the movie are just outright told to you, because in this book, it is told in, I believe it's third-person omniscient, where, you know, we just go, there's an unnamed narrator, we go into everybody's head, we see all their thoughts, and so things that are a mystery in the movie aren't a mystery in the book, because, you know, in the movie you're like, oh, they betrayed, blah, 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 and then in the book you just go into Todd's head, and Todd's like, yes, I'm going to betray, blah, blah, blah. And you're like, oh, well, when's that gonna happen? You know, it's almost more the mystery now of when it's gonna happen, because you know it's gonna happen in the book. As you can see, I haven't made a ton of progress in it, because, like I said, March has been busy, but I really want to crank this one out. I enjoy it. I got the box set. You know, this was like $20 for the box set of the original trilogy that has Dune, Messiah, and Children of. And so I at least definitely want to finish Dune and get into Messiah, because those are what Villeneuve has said he wants to adapt. So, yeah, not a whole lot of reading, because big, thick book in a busy month. Then when it comes to video games I played this month, I'm still playing Overwatch. This season has grown on me. I didn't like it. You know, they had the mid-season patch where they turned down the damage debuff and things like that, and I think the game is in a better place now. Playing tank doesn't feel as terrible anymore, and playing support actually feels possible now versus before the DPS without damageless supports. This is a team fighting game, if you don't know, 5v5, where you play as specific heroes, and all those heroes, they have different abilities. The new hero, they put the new hero Venture in the game for this past weekend to play test them out. I think they're really fun. You know, they're a mole person. They go down into the ground and they pop up, and then they've got these like explosive short range shots that deal. And their damage probably needs cranked down a bit. Their ult and their primary fire are a little crazy. But I think they'll be an interesting addition to the game. Then my friends and I continued to liberate Super Earth with Helldivers 2. They upped the difficulty of the game, and they added the mechs. And the mechs are a mess. You know, you end up friendly firing your team half the time. But it leads to, you know, the game is inherently funny. I think that's what brings everybody back. Yes, it is like the same 10 missions recycled over and over again. But it's the fact that they never play out the same anytime, you know. You're constantly getting bombarded by enemies or blown up. My friends and I, we were playing on one of the harder difficulties, and we just got Bile Titan after Bile Titan, and it was an incredibly fun and hard time, but the struggle is what makes it interesting. Then, finally, way too late after launch, Spider-Man 2 got its New Game Plus update, and this added features that should have been in the game from the start, like alternate suits for the symbiote, being able to select specific mission titles, wearing whatever costume you want in any mission, you know, being able to change your tendril colors, time of day, all that kind of stuff that should have been there at launch. We know this game got crunched and sped out because we just keep seeing more and more stuff from the dev team of what was supposed to be in the game. But I do think this New Game Plus update was for the better, and it did bring me back to swing around the city for a bit. I don't think the story of Spider-Man 2 has aged so gracefully with me. You know, there are definitely some boring bits of the story where you're like, come on. But overall, I do think this was a positive change. I played a bit of Fortnite because of the new Greek mythology season. You know, I played that with Morgan M. Steele. And I think that's interesting. I haven't been able to get into Fortnite lately. Like, I was really into it a few seasons ago, and then I've kind of fallen out of it and fallen into Overwatch. And so, maybe I need to give it a few more goes, but I think it is interesting. It is fun. Then, does anybody remember Plants vs. Zombies? So, I had somebody mention to me Plants vs. Zombies the other day, talking about their kid. You know, my kid is playing Plants vs. Zombies. And that had me like, oh my goodness. I used to play Plants vs. Zombies. And so, I did. I have Game Pass, and Plants vs. Zombies is included on Game Pass. It's also only like $5 on Steam if you want it. So, I ended up buying Plants vs. Zombies, and I have been playing that through, and it's a fun, if you don't know what it is, this is like a strategy kind of arcade game where you place your plants in various positions to defend your home from zombies. You know, you've got things like pea shooters that shoot the zombies, you've got sunflowers that generate energy that you then have to use that energy to buy more pea shooters, things like that. I really like that game. I think it's a fun strategy. I kind of miss it, you know, because the more recent entries have gone like the third and first person shooter routes of it, and I just don't think they capture that original charm. Then, because of all the ghostbusting, I played Ghostbusters the video game, another video game from my childhood that I wanted to revisit, you know, so I was able to get the remaster super cheap because of the spring sale, and so I played a little bit of that. I recorded some of it. Maybe that'll become a video. We'll have to see. This is where you're playing as an unnamed rookie. You know, you're the fifth Ghostbuster. And I think the game is fun, if not a little limited. You know, it is an older PS3 game, so nothing too crazy. But definitely a fun nostalgia trip for the small time that I played it. Then, finally, this last Thursday, Suicide Squad Kill the Justice League had its big Season 1 update that added the Joker. And, man, did they fumble this so hard. So, it's no secret that the game has been a flop for WB, and this needed to be kind of the game-saving grace, and it wasn't, because they got greedy. So, you might think, I didn't really love that game, I've kind of fallen out of it, but I want to go check out the Joker. Well, guess what? The Joker is locked behind level 35, and they reset your level for the DLC. It's free, but you now have to play for how many hours to get to level 35. Or you can pay $10 and unlock him now. You know, very scummy way of going about it. And then with it, Joker had no story with him. It was just the character this time. They split the season in half and have said more content is coming in the back half. So hopefully there's some story in that, because there's not really anything here. Just a lot more recycled missions with a new character that I think the Joker plays alright. I don't really love him that much. But anyways, that's the stuff I checked out in March. Let me know how you spent March in the comments down below. If you liked what you saw here, I talk about nerdy stuff all the time, so don't forget to like, subscribe, and hit the bell so you know when that next one's coming. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.